Welcome. Welcome to Broadmoor Community Church, a church that does believe so strongly, no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. I'm Reverend Ann Cubbage, and it is my privilege to be the senior pastor here. As we come into this Advent season on the second week of Advent, preparation for the birth of our Messiah, there are many, many activities that may grab your attention, may pull you away. But I want to say that if this season is getting the best of you, if you have lost somebody, if you just need prayer, I would be honored. And there are slides at the end of this worship service that you can find my email and contact information. I would love to hear from you. Or better yet, if you are in town, please know you can drop by at 315 Lake Avenue. I also wanted to let you know that we have a blue Christmas service just for you. It is on the 20th of December at 6:30 p.m. It is a secular service with a tinge of hope. If you know somebody or if you were in that place and are in town, please come by. You will be blessed. I also wanted to let you know that as we continue through this season, we will ultimately come to Christmas Eve. And on Christmas Eve in the morning, we will have our pageant. Now, unfortunately, it will not be online. It will only be in person. There will be a service, but it won't be the pageant. And then in the evening, we have two services here, 5 and 7. And you will have opportunity to access a beautiful candlelight service. I know that you have many things that pull at you, that ask things from you, and I want to say thank you. Thank you for your generosity. Thank you for the time that you spend praying for us. Thank you for your financial gifts. If you have not found your way to our website, I would invite you to that. It will give you an opportunity to hit the give button, and then you can choose how you want to give. It is because of you that the ministries of this church are so robust, that the missions of this church continue to reach out to our neighbors in unimaginable and wonderful ways. Thank you for your generosity. And now I invite you to take in a deep breath and to let it out as we prepare for worship. Holy God, we know that you are near. We know that you are standing at the door. You are running down the driveway. You are inviting us in, into your word, into relationship, and deeper into joy. So as we approach your word, O God, we pray, do not let us pass you by. Do not allow distraction or doubt to get the best of us. Do not let us walk down this road without you. Instead, give us the wisdom to turn and run your way. Give us the wisdom to hear your wisdom, to let it sink into our bones and change us. With hope and gratitude, we pray. Amen.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water?
Mary, did you know your baby boy would save our sons and daughters?
Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby
to the blind man? Mary, did you know
How does a weary world practice peace? By listening before we speak and saying sorry when we need to. By advocating for justice and caring for our neighbor. By practicing Sabbath and forgiving 70 times 7. By choosing grace over hate and opening the door for each other. There are a million ways to practice peace. So today, we light the candle of peace as a reminder and a change. With God's help, may we bring peace into a weary world. Amen.
Hi everyone, it's Miss Liz. How are you today? It's so good to see you. Thanks for watching. So, my friends, we are now in the second week of Advent. If you remember from last week, we talked about how Advent is a special season before Christmas, where we prepare our hearts for the birth of Jesus. Each week in Advent has a special theme. Last week, our theme was hope. And this week, our theme is peace. Have you ever experienced the peace of God? Sometimes we can just feel this peace. We feel a sense of comfort and well-being that comes over us. But a lot of times, we experience God's peace through other people. For example, maybe you have been very scared of something, or very scared in a particular situation, and you have found that your parents or grandparents or other caregivers come close to you and they help you feel less afraid. They help you experience God's peace. Or perhaps you have been very worried about something and you share this with one of your friends. And maybe your friend helps you feel less worried. Your friend helps you experience God's peace. And my friends, you can also be someone who helps others experience God's peace. You can help others when they feel afraid or scared or worried. You can help them experience the peace of God. So why don't we say a prayer? We will thank God for this peace. You can repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for your love. Thank you for your peace. Thank you for other people who help me experience your peace. Let me be someone who passes your peace to others. We love you, God. Amen. All right, my friends, go out, have a wonderful week, and may you experience the peace of God.
The scripture reading comes today just after our reading from last week's scripture. This is in Luke chapter 1, beginning with verse 26. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Hail, O favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was greatly troubled at the saying and considered in her mind what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give him the throne of the father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." And Mary said to the angel, "How shall this be, since I have no husband?" And the angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child will be born and will be called Holy, the Son of God. And behold, your kinswoman Elizabeth in her old age has also conceived a son, and this is the sixth month with her who is called barren. For with God, nothing will be impossible." And Mary said, "Behold, I am the handmaid of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. In those days, Mary arose and went with haste into the hill country to a city of Judah. And she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. And when Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary, the babe leapt in her womb. And Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. And she exclaimed with a loud cry, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And why is this granted me, that the mother of my Lord should come to me? For behold, when the voice of your greeting came to my ears, the babe in my womb leapt for joy. And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her from the Lord." In the familiar Christmas hymn, O Holy Night, we hear the words, a thrill of hope, the weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. What a dream. What a wonder. Our Advent theme this year comes from these words. In the midst of every generation, people need to hear these words. There comes a time of weariness, individually and societally. During the 1800s, the words to this song were written by a French poet who was atheist, and the music was supplied by a Jewish composer. I can imagine that these two felt the weight of the world. And despite their lack of belief in the efficacy and power of Jesus the Christ, their work allowed for hope, for a just and peaceful world. The hymn reminds us that justice and joy belong together. Even when, maybe especially when, we are weary, our joy is an act of resistance, the resistance to find peace. When we are weary, we find it difficult to express our joy. When we are weary, we might find it tough to share space with others because our weariness has seemingly stolen our joy. However, I wonder, is it even possible to be joy-filled by yourself? Reverend Anna Strickland, a creator of our series, writes, my first pregnancy was due just days before Christmas. I imagined giving birth amidst the singing of joy to the world. But 9 weeks into the pregnancy, the Wednesday after Mother's Day, I miscarried. I spent the long Texas summer mourning the loss. By the time December finally came, I was 4 months pregnant with a daughter who would be born on Easter. As I prepared the nursery that winter, my joy was interrupted by a wave of grief for the child I never met, the child who would have been arriving in days, not months. In the midst of what everyone saw as a joyous season, for me, there was this hidden pain I felt. I thought that I needed to tuck it away. My grief felt so unearned. But so did my joy. For Strickland, peace was difficult to hold on to. And when we find ourselves in such a place, this scripture reminds us that it is in community, in the midst of the ordinary, the God-beloved but flawed humanity, that our joy can expand, that the peace of God can fill our hearts, minds, and our bodies. When we cannot rejoice, we can carry each other's joy. That's what Elizabeth and Mary do for one another. The good news begins to take shape in Elizabeth's womb, but Scripture tells us that she stays secluded. That is, until Mary, a young, unmarried, pregnant, and until then, insignificant relative, from an unimportant province arrives at her door. Perhaps Mary's arrival is the inbreaking that changes everything for Elizabeth. For in that moment, her child leaps in her womb and she is filled with the Holy Spirit. She can't help but rejoice. Her joy is contagious and wraps around Mary like a hug. This is the comfort we can give to and receive from each other during this season and beyond. In connection, redemption, joy, and peace can be found. We do want to honor, however, the ways that our joy can expand when it is shared with others, but we also want to be mindful of all those who may be experiencing loneliness and isolation throughout the holidays. Those who are weary, those for whom peace seems impossible. Therefore, It is important to emphasize that joy is fundamentally rooted in connection. Peace can be found in community, but connection reaches beyond just human relationships. We experience peace through a feeling, through a deep connection to ourselves, through our connection to loved ones, to God, to nature, and in fact, to the whole universe that surrounds us. It makes me ask whether it might be that internal joy and peace can only be realized in external connections. Shared joy is one way that a weary world can rejoice. We find Elizabeth alone for 5 months. There's no indication in the text that explains her isolation, but we hear her weariness and then her resolve. Hear these words. "This is what the Lord has done for me, when he looked favorably on me and took away the disgrace I have endured among my people." Many, many sermons on this text have emphasized how Elizabeth provided sanctuary for Mary. However, what if Mary's arrival is what pulls Elizabeth out of her seclusion, allowing her to experience joy and peace of mind? We are not sure about Mary's travels. She sets out with haste, we hear, to enter the house of Zechariah and to greet Elizabeth. We don't know if she traveled alone, but we do know she was on a mission to get clarity about her own encounter with the angel Gabriel. We don't hear her internal dialogue during her travels, but I can imagine her thinking, "Does God know how young I am? How can he have called me favored? I haven't even been married yet, and now I'm pregnant? I thought favor meant I would have prosperity, acceptability, and comfort." The shame of being with child without being married first has caused me to be weary. So how am I supposed to rejoice with this? We don't hear her questions, but we witness her resolve and her obedience, her acceptance that she, an ordinary person, might bring God's hope despite the depravity, violence, and corruption in the world. By seeing her travel, we can see her desire to be with God, and we can see and recognize her desire to be with her relative, Elizabeth. Two pregnant women meeting and sharing their experiences with one another, chatting and hanging out. Two pregnant women who are related but so, so different from one another. One is young, one is old. One is married, one is not yet. One is carrying the word of God, and one is carrying the one who prepares the way. They were separate from one another when they got the news of God's plans for their lives, and it is when they are connected that they experience shared joy. It is when they come out of their isolation that joy becomes the connection. Even if neither can feel joy for themselves, they are both holding joy for each other. From that connection, joy grows. Reverend Cecilia D. Armstrong writes, "If comfort is a necessity in this weary world, then rejoicing should be done in the company of others. Mary and Elizabeth have shown us joy in joining and comfort in connecting." And in her book, Atlas of the Heart, one of my favorite authors, Brené Brown, defines joy as an intense feeling of deep spiritual connection, pleasure, and appreciation. She says, "Joy is characterized by a connection with others, or with God, nature, or the universe. Connection is fundamental to experiences of joy and a key to peace of mind. Mary sought out her kin. Elizabeth was pulled out of her isolation and filled with the Holy Spirit. We do not need to do the hard things alone. There is power in connection. So if you are weary this season, if you feel like joy is out of reach, undeserved, or fleeting, If your pain is tucked away in the closet with the Christmas presents, I hope you'll find comfort sitting with Mary, Zechariah, Elizabeth, and the shepherds as angels bring their greetings of, "Do not fear." I hope you will seek out answers and wisdom from others. I hope that you will experience peace even in the midst of this chaotic, difficult world. I hope that you will recognize that you too, an ordinary and God-beloved human, can carry the good news to your relatives, your friends, and ultimately the world. Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. Amen. As we come to this time of prayer, I would invite you to a bit of silence, and then I will say the prayers of the people, and we will together join in the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Let us pray. God of laughter, God of opened front doors and family reunions, we confess that we often doubt the good news. We move through this world waiting for the other shoe to drop, waiting for life to fall apart, waiting for our humanity to get the best of us. Instead of leaning into joy, we lean into scarcity. We lean into fear. We lean into isolation. Forgive us for forgetting that joy is amplified when shared. Heal the wounds we have from past hurts and teach us how to throw open our doors like Elizabeth. Show us how to find joy in connection. And on this day, God, we ask your touch in our world, to bring peace to the Middle East, to bring peace to Ukraine, to bring peace to Africa, to bring peace in our own country, in our own homes, in our own hearts. And we pray these things in the name of your Son, the Prince of Peace, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Faith. As you go out into the world, you go into a weary world. So speak tenderly. Do the good that is yours to do. Choose connection. Hold on to hope. And remember that Christ took on flesh for you. You are God's beloved. So go rejoicing. The world needs it.